Don't forget, you can follow the show on Twitter. At PitchPass is our Twitter handle. Pretty easy. And there's some interesting stuff on there once in a while. Charlie mentioned Eddie Johnson in our conversation about Mike McGee, which got me thinking. So I put our friend Kyle Sheldon on the case to see if we could track down Eddie Johnson. Just talk to him. Not so much about the tumultuousness of the last 6 months, but to find out more about the guy, the man, Eddie Johnson, if you will. Kyle, he made it happen. And Eddie Johnson joins us right now on Pitch Pass. Eddie, how are you, sir?
I'm good. How are you, Greg?
I'm good. Thanks for taking some time. I appreciate it.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
We're going to ask some hard-hitting questions, Eddie. I hope you got the gloves on and you're ready to go at it with me, because we got to get into it. And I think the first question we should ask is, tell me all about Man Crush Mondays.
Man Crush Monday, I see a couple guys. Follow the rapper of the game on Instagram, and he do a couple Man Crush Mondays of himself. So I was like, you know what? Took one of the photos from us in Trenton the other day, and I was like, all right, I'm going to give a shout-out to myself. Sometimes we look out for others more than we look out for ourselves. So I was just showing myself some love on Instagram.
So you've instituted a Man Crush Mondays in the United locker room?
Nah, it was a photo that was taken during a session at training. We were doing some weights and some band workouts. And I thought it was a good photo for me to put up for followers with that they can like.
That question comes from Bobby Boswell, by the way. He said, hey, make sure you ask Eddie about who his Man Crush Monday is.
It doesn't surprise me coming from Bobby.
Now, I remember...
I'll give him crap later on.
Now, I remember back in the day when Bobby first started playing and was on United, he and I are pretty friendly, and he would always say that he enjoyed when, at the time, the Wizards came to town, because he liked hanging out with you. You were always a lot of fun to hang out with. But when you guys went to the club, you were very generous about picking up tabs, and as a guy who was making only 30 grand or such at the time, he really appreciated when you guys came to town, specifically you, Eddie.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of people that don't know, you know, they only see me when I'm on the field, and you know, I'm out there competing and being competitive, and you know, being really emotional. You know, I'm a very caring and giving person, and you know, if you're a friend of mine, or if you're close to me, you know, whenever we go out, you know, it's all about me having a good time with the people that I care about, and that means a lot to me. And I think I've covered a couple of his tabs in the past. But Bobby's a good friend of mine. We go way back, and you know, it's sad to be on the same team as him and not competing against each other.
And now he's making a little money. He's on his own now, right, Eddie?
I mean, I think we're all a lot older now. We got responsibilities now. you know, Bobby has a kid. You know, I got two kids, and you know, it's about being a lot more smarter with our money and not going out and enjoying it. I'd say, you know, like we did in our earlier 20s in the league.
Now, let me ask you, if this was going on and this was happening in D.C., were there guys on teams throughout the league that was like, okay, you know, we're going to X town, and this guy's my boy, and I know he's just getting started, so if we happen to do go somewhere after the match, I'll probably pick up the food tab or something like that? Was that happening in a lot of cities?
I did it for all my boys. I mean, all of them that are close to me or that are listening to this interview or that's going to, you know, hear about it. You know, I always took care of my boys wherever. If it was in Dallas, the guys that I was teammates in Dallas when I left to Kansas City, or if it was guys in Kansas City when I left to go to Europe and I came back in Seattle, if it was in Seattle, you know, all those guys know, you know, when I go out, I'll be the first one to get the tab, you know, because, you know, like you said, some people don't earn as much. You know, I've been very fortunate in my career to make some good money. And, you know, I love to enjoy myself around the one that I care about, and that means a lot.
I wanted to go back to the beginning with you, Eddie, because I don't think I've ever seen it laid out anywhere specifically, and that is how you got started in the sport of soccer. Like you, I grew up in an inner city, and so playing soccer, maybe not even, I won't even say it was the cool thing to do. A lot of times it wasn't even an option. For me personally, I had to drive out to the suburbs to play soccer or to play organized soccer. So how did you get started with the sport?
I tell you, like, I never had played a organized sport. And one day I was just so happened to be walking home with my mother in the city back in Bonnell, Florida. And, you know, I see my friends running after this truck, and this truck was like, there was just this black guy, and he pulled over, and I ran behind the truck, too, because my friends were running. And long story short, I asked them what they're doing. They said, sign up for soccer. So I asked my mom if I can sign up, but at the time I was too young because all my friends were like three, 4 years older than me. So I ended up playing, you know, that first year, and that same summer, my mom was put up for a summer camp program, and I met these three guys, and at my summer camp, that played soccer, competitive soccer, and became friends with them, and they wanted me to come try out for their team. And I wasn't that good at the time to play competitive soccer. You know, my first year I played recreational soccer, and you know, I think I made the team because I was friends with the coach's son. But I was a very competitive person, and I always picked up on things really quick. And you know, that's how I got started. You know, no interest to really play the sport, didn't know anything about it. But you know, like anything. Sports-wise, I did. I was always competitive, and I got good at it.
And how old were you when you had that first initial brush with playing soccer?
9 years old.
And so before that, you just kind of running around and doing things like with your friends and playing sports that way?
Yeah, just, you know, it was just playing pickup basketball at the YMCA and you know, doing, you know, sports and PE in elementary. You know, that's the only time I really played sports. You know, my mom really didn't have the money financially to sign me up for sports and stuff. And, you know, I met some friends that were financially stable, and one of those friends happened to be a good friend of mine, and his dad was a coach, so they took care of a lot of the expenses in soccer for me.
And at what point did it dawn on you, wait a second, I'm actually pretty good at this, not so much like amongst your friends, but thinking in a bigger picture of, wait a second, this could be something that I could do and take it far, whether it's even getting a scholarship to college or getting a varsity letter in high school?
Well, when I turned 10, I was playing up 2 years. I was playing under 12 competitive soccer. And then after my first year playing up 2 years, I went down to my age, and then we started going to tournaments throughout the state of Florida. And my first year of competitive soccer, I was a sweeper. And then when I went down to my age group, my coach turned me into a striker. I just started scoring goals in different tournaments and started getting the recognition of ODP scouts and stuff. And I did my first year doing ODP. I was 12 years old. And then that year I made the Florida State team, and then I did the whole regional thing and made the Region 3 team, and then I made the national team my first year too. And that's when I started doing a lot more traveling abroad and stuff, and that's where I realized, like, hey man, you know I'm pretty good at this, and I got a better appreciation for the sport because I saw it on a global standpoint and how big it was and how meaningful the games were and how big they were over in different countries and stuff. And so that's when I started to take it serious.
I don't even know if they let you play up age anymore, because I know I got a kid, and they don't let them go any more than 1 year ahead of what they are. So it has to be an advantage to be able to play up 2 years.
Yeah, I think it helped me out a lot. You know, it was faster. It was more guys are more strong.
Yeah.
You had to think quickly. You had to make faster decisions on the field and stuff. And so I think that helped me a lot. But when I went back down to my age after that year, you know, I was able to, they were pretty much to like dominate in tournaments and stuff. You know, the Labor Day tournaments, the Halloween, Christmas tournaments, played 5 games. I ended up with like 17 goals in the whole tournament and stuff. So it was crazy, man. So, you know, that's when I started getting a lot of recognition and stuff.
I saw when you got down for the first leg of DC United spring training, it was at the IMG Academy at Bradenton. What was it like for you heading back there? I know you sent out a couple of tweets about how it was kind of almost emotional for you to go back to where it all started. What was it like going back to Bradenton this early preseason?
Yeah, like you said, you know, it was very emotional for me because that gave me a chance to make everything that I'm doing right now a reality. You know, to get opportunities in life, and you know, and no one's to say that, no one's, it's not promised that you're gonna, you know, after IMG go on, you know, to become, you know, that player, you know, that they try to make you into be. And, you know, me going down there, you know, really helped me put myself in a situation to be able to provide for my family and then now for my kids and stuff. And so, like, you know, when I came back from England and I was out for, you know, six, 7 months with no club. You know, I went back down there, and where it all started for me, and got myself around the positive people and the people that helped push me to get myself into the MLS and stuff. And then I got picked up by Seattle, and I had a, you know, one of my breakout years in my career.
Yeah.
My first year back here in the league and stuff. So it was emotional for me to go back down there and just see all those faces and you know, to reflect on you know what it was like when I was a young teenager on a day to day basis and everything that I did and how different they are now and how much it's changed and how much it's grown and how much soccer is getting big, you know, bigger and bigger down there. So it was a good feeling being down there, and it was a good camp.
You know, it is getting bigger, but on the other hand, there isn't that situation where the U.S. is sending their best and brightest to the academy. This is more of an MLS club academy kind of system now. What are the pros and cons of the way it was then and the way it is now? And do you think you would have been as successful as you are if there hadn't have been, or if there were only MLS academies at that point?
I just think the timing is different for I think everyone. You know, I think you know, when I was young, up and coming, you know, the 82s, which, you know, they were the first cycle down there, then the 84s and the 86s and stuff. I think, you know, at that time, I think that was the best possible situation as far as getting the best young players in their age in a professional environment where they can, you know, get their education and also get the training from a soccer standpoint and from a physical standpoint with the IPI at the time that it was called down there, IMG, you know, for us to be able to, when we leave that program, to be able to, you know, to go, you know, if we went to the MLS, to be able to compete and, you know, be as competitive as we can against, you know, the pros leaving out of that program. But now, you know, I think the success that we have with our national team in the 2002 World Cup, I think, you know, a lot, we gained a lot more respect from, you know, from a global standpoint, you know, for us as American soccer players in our country. So I think having those and investing more in having these academies now and you know, putting our best young talented players in a good environment where they can play and get good competition and get good, you know, games, I think it's only going to make, you know, the future for U.S. soccer better, and it's only going to help this league grow and be a lot more better and a lot more exciting, and have a lot more exciting young players, you know, breaking through their first teams at a younger age. So I think it's at our time, I think it was right, you know, having the residency program, and then I think it's, you know, as soccer has grown and as it continues to grow and how our national team continues to do well, I think it's beneficial having these academies here now in the MLS.
Now, were you there with Mike McGee?
Yeah, for me, one of the best strikers in the box that I've ever played with.
And so when I talked to him about his IMG experience, I didn't realize this, but it was a lot like high school. So you were socializing with the other athletes. He was mentioning the girls who were playing tennis were the girls that he had his eye on when he was down there. He also talked about like proms and stuff. So did you attend proms at Bradenton?
No, I didn't get lucky like McGee. He's a handsome guy, you know.
He is.
You know, a handsome guy, very outgoing, great personality. I was a bit shy and, to myself. And down in Bradenton, but I think Craig Capano, if that name rings a bell, back in the day when he was with us, and a couple others went to prom. You know, the good looking guys, the studs, you know, that don't have to try. You know, girls just want them to come and hang out with them and stuff. But yeah, you know, we got a chance to, you know, Maria Sharapova was down there with us, so we saw her and when she was young before she became, you know, big time, and we used to hang out with her and stuff and. It was good, you know. It was all the best young, talented athletes in different sports. You know, you get to, you know, interact with each other. So it was an amazing experience.
Now, are you also confirming what McGee said, which is the best looking girls were the tennis girls, or are you going to go a different sport?
Nah, I'm going to go with the tennis players, man. they had this big tennis tournament around like Christmas. It was called the Eddie Herr. It's like a big tournament back at IMG where like all the tennis players come from over the world, and it's like a week long. And we always used to look forward to that. We used to always look forward to it.
Yeah, but Eddie, how hard must it have been for you at 15, 16 years old? Maria Sharapova is already 5'11". You can't be like what, 5'8", 5'9", at that point?
Nah, I think I was always around like 6 foot.
All right.
5'11". I think I was always pretty tall. You know, one of the taller ones in our group on the youth national team. So I didn't get those little man syndrome jokes at all.
Yeah, so Sharapova wouldn't have to worry about wearing heels around you, whereas with McGee, she'd have to wear the flats all the time.
Yes, flats.
So your last Instagram video that you sent out was you post match in the ice bath, which I always kind of look at because as a guy who's also getting a little older now, I didn't really think about ice baths before. I never wanted to get in an ice bath, still don't want to get an ice bath, but you can really feel the difference in the ice bath. Is that something in your 20s, your early 20s, where you were like, I don't need that ice bath? And now 29, looking at 30, it's like, get me in that ice bath.
Wait a second. What's your Instagram? What's your Instagram? So I can know what your name is. No. I'm kidding. I just think the direction. You know, I think America, we're starting to get it now. I think at a younger age, you know, all the younger guys now, you know, and having, you know, the nutritionists and athletes and performance and stuff. I think the younger guys are starting to get it now. Whereas when we were younger, we weren't really more forced to do ice baths and stuff now. But as far as recovery, I mean, the best athletes in the world do it. The LeBron James, the Cristiano Ronaldo, the Michael Jordan used to do it a lot after every training session in basketball games. But the older you get, you know, the more smarter you get as far as, you know, how you, you know, your diet, your recovery and learning your body and knowing what you have to do to get yourself right and prepare for the next game. And, you know, you want to give yourself longevity.
Yeah.
You know, I'm getting up there in age. So it's all about me, doing the right things to, you know, to keep me feeling young and fresh and competing against these young guys that are busy and running around and physical and stuff in this league. So I really take advantage of the ice bath. I do it after every training session when it's there. And if it's not there, you know, it's massages and stuff, and it's getting the right amount of fluids back into you after every session. You know, so I always try and give myself advantages.
Your last 6 months has been well documented. The one thing I would be curious to know about your 6 month experience of everything that you've been through is you looking back on everything that happened at the end of your time with Seattle and now your move to DC. Do you have any regrets as to things, maybe things that you did over the last 6 months, or would you change something that happened over the last 6 months?
I wouldn't change anything. I think we all know, soccer is a business, you know, so it's like, you know what you're getting yourself into when you sign a contract or you go to a certain team. You know, at the end of the day, there can be a chance that you might get traded or your service isn't good enough anymore. So you got to expect that. I went there to do a job. I felt like I did my job for 2 years. Numbers don't lie. You know, if you go back and you look from a statistic standpoint, I was a 1-2 goal scorer my two years there. But at the end of the day, if you go to work and you feel like you're not being valued the way you should be valued, then I think it's time for you to go. And whatever the reasoning it was, I don't think anyone's came out publicly and said anything, whatever the reason it was for, me not being there no more. You know, I'm still, lost in the wind. But I enjoyed my 2 years there. You know, I thank the coach, Ziggy Smith, and Chris Henderson and Adrian for giving me an opportunity to get my career back on track, and I had a fantastic 2 years in Seattle.
I got to ask you about a couple of players. I'm in D.C. By the way, it's snowing here, Eddie, as we record this, so I'm sure you're looking forward to leaving Charleston and getting back up to the snowy nation's capital, right?
And from someone that's been in the sun all his life, I've gotten used to the cold from being in Europe and then going to Seattle. I don't mind the cold, man. I really don't.
What about the snow? Do you mind the snow?
I don't mind the snow at all.
So let me ask you about a couple of guys, or at least one guy. Let's just focus on one guy because he's been a bit of a mystery because he didn't play last year, and that would be Francois, the rookie out of Maryland. What have you seen from him during preseason that you've liked, and how long do you think it'll be before United fans start seeing him in action?
Well, it's funny you say that because he was one of the guys from my first session. Down in Florida, when I joined the team, he was one of the, guys that caught my eye, and that I was really impressed, and I see a lot of potential in him, and I didn't know anything about him before I came there. He has everything. He has everything to be an unbelievable player, a great player in this league, and do well for himself. I think the coaches just need to do a really good job of managing him and giving him every advantage to succeed in this league. I talk to him when I can when we have little breaks here in between sessions and stuff. And I try to use some of my experiences and stuff of being outside and. Playing outside on the wing to help him make him become a more unpredictable player when he's out there. But he has everything. He has speed. He has pace. He can take you on 1v1. He has a good touch. And, I'm looking for him to do really good things this year.
Well, Eddie, I'm looking forward to you coming up, settling in D.C., being here for a few years, and when you're finally back up in D.C., settled in, we'll have to hang out and say hello to each other personally in person.
Yeah, for sure. I don't want to be there for a few years, man. I'm tired of moving around. I'm getting old. So if I can retire in D.C., I'm happy.
That's fine with me, my friend. Thank you for taking some time. I appreciate it.
All right, thank you for your time.
For more show information, go to pitchpass.com.